Guess I better bring the notes.
I'm probably going to guess in here.
Universalist Church of New Madison, this beautiful, bright spring, actually seems like spring, sunny day now. Our theme this week is going to be ecology, and it's kind of something I've put together out of a bunch of stuff, so it's not going to make a lot of sense, but it may give you something to start you on. And it's also going to continue on, which what I've talked about before, is the kind of cyclical thing of civilization kind of up and down. So we're going to put kind of that all together, and hopefully it'll give you some food for thought. I want to thank Kenny for the flowers. I totally walked off today and forgot I was going to have to go to the neighbors and see tulips out of their garden. And, he was nice enough to bring something. Janet's funeral was this week. Derek did an excellent job. The place was packed. I didn't get to go to the cemetery. I had other obligations, but Kenny says that was really exceptional, too. So if you missed that, you've missed a really decent service about a really decent person. So we're going to miss Janet in the future, right straight through. Okay, obviously, our theme on ecology is going to center on wolves. And the reason for that is, last week I heard a thing on the news that in Idaho, the conservative congressional group or conservative state legislature has passed a law or a new program they're going to do. The ranchers and hunters are complaining about too many wolves. They've counted approximately 1,100 and they're going to eliminate 90% of them.
Ooh.
They're going to hunt them down to 100, and you know when you turn the hunters loose, they'll be lucky if there's 100 of them left. That's the reason we're talking about ecology, and that's the reason we're coupling it with the cyclical thing of civilization. What is driving people to act like this? And we're going to talk about something called Trophic, Cascade. If you're not familiar with that, it's a pretty interesting concept. It's what they discovered after what happened in Yellowstone Park when they reintroduced wolves. And it's a pretty incredible and a real reason to not eliminate the wolves. So our welcome, at the end of the Permian period, 251 million years ago, global warming caused the worst mass extinction in the history of the planet. That time, a 6 degrees Celsius increase in the global temperature was enough to kill 95% of the species that were alive on the Earth. This extinction is called the Great Dying. Gigantic volcanic eruptions caused this warming by triggering a runaway greenhouse effect that nearly put an end to life on Earth. Conditions in what geologists have termed a post-apocalyptic greenhouse were so severe that only one large land animal was left alive and fewer than 1 in 10 species survived. And the reason I bring this up is if you read the current projections on where we're going with global warming, we're getting close to the 6 degree mark is going to be what we achieve. And we already saw in the past, millions of years ago, what the result of that was. So I think it would behoove us to pay attention to that and maybe try and do something about it. Do we have any announcements? We're still working on the flower planting, so we'll get together and let people know how we do on that. Lou's due back this week, and he's kind of going to be heading that up, so we'll see what plans he has in mind, and we'll go from there. Prelude, please. And this will be, on a clear day, you can see forever, and we're really happy to have Roberta back with us.
Thank you.
a clear day you can see forever, and I sincerely hope forever is as beautiful as today. Before I change the camera angle, I want to ask everybody's opinion. With the camera set, you can't see this, so only the people here can see it. I have considered moving the banner to here, which when we're doing the music, then the banner will show up on the, does that sound like a possibility? So if that's acceptable to everybody, we'll keep making changes to adapt to the new reality of life. Everything is electronic. And I can happily report, when Derek is here, we have like almost 30 or 40 people. When Nancy was here, we had like 55 or 60 people watch. So we're gonna try and get them back in the office. Chalice lighting. We light this chalice, a spark of the original fire of creation. And as the electronic age, we have no longer fire except for the chalice itself. To remind us that we all on this planet, the furred, the feathered, the finned, the scaled, along with us featherless bipeds, we all are made of the same star stuff and share a common destiny. We all share the same hopes of a life free from harm and suffering, and the same aspirations of happiness, love, and flourishing, being able to express our own unique natures and capacities as best we may. We are just that many diverse perspectives from which the whole is seen and experienced. We are inextricably intertwined and interconnected and interdependent, and it is good. Blessed be. Our opening hymn is 21. Source of all, to thee we raise this, our hymn of great praise. It's nice when the theme and the music kind of blend together, so I appreciate the effort that everybody's putting into that. affirmation is going to go along on the ethical line, is Ethical Eating by Mary Gibb. For those suffering from malnutrition, if they are lucky, powdered milk and a cup of cereal provided by International Aid Organization may be all they can look forward to meal after meal, and perhaps clean water to drink with it. In the U.S., we waste 3,044 pounds of food per second. All the imperfect food that is culled from the fields, the food that is left in the fields after mechanical harvest, the blemished and bruised food that comes to the grocery, the food that doesn't get purchased and begins to decay on the shelves, the edible byproducts of the production of food are discarded. Food that is overproduced and cannot be sold is discarded. The food on our plates that doesn't get eaten that goes down the disposal or to the landfill. If we believe that providing adequate food is a human rights issue, then we must understand the imbalance of food delivery, acquisition, consumption, and the damage that is done to all living things by the industrialized growing and transporting of food and the raising of farm animals in unnatural circumstances. It may surprise you that up to 37% of greenhouse gases are produced in the production of food. Oops, I forgot to put the camera back. Sorry for that little delay. If we believe that we live in the interconnected web, that life is of value, that our environment is worth saving, that the disappearance of species in record numbers is unacceptable, then we have choices to make. You hear a lot about driving less, turning the heat down, using less hot water, and insulating your house. You can change the course of environmental and human degradation that we are now experiencing. I'll make a few suggestions. Buy organic and natural. I've heard folks claim that because organic products cost more, buying organic is unaffordable and elitist. I've read articles in which the writer claims that organic foods don't taste any better than commercially grown food and that you should save your money. I believe that as people who care about the world outside of ourselves, when we look at the toll that commercially grown foods take on the environment and the health of the people who do the work in the fields, we can't afford not to buy organic foods. Eat less meat. If you are worried about getting enough protein in your diet, educate yourself about how to combine grains and legumes and dairy products to create complete proteins. Use meat as a flavoring rather than a main dish. Seek out meat that has been grass-fed and finished and humanely raised. You could even go vegan if you want to learn to eat the proper foods needed for a balanced diet. I personally would not go that far. And the other thing, if you want to, we talked about eat less meat. Have you heard this was kind of antithetical, the complaint that the Republicans or conservatives are reduced to with the new Biden administration. Fox News has been posting a thing about you're going to only be allowed 4 pounds of meat per year, and that the hamburger is going to be outlawed. All of this is totally made up by the Daily Mail, which is a scandal sheet in Britain and then picked up by Fox News. Everybody knows that's not true. They don't even have to say that it's not true. But that's what we're reduced to in opposition to what's going on in Washington, is to tell people and try and scare people that they won't be allowed to eat meat anymore. So we're back to become a food activist. Educate yourself about food production and distribution. Talk to your government representatives when farm bills and aid bills are being considered. Tell them to think democratically, that's a little d, democratically and environmentally when considering food subsidies and aid to foreign countries. Consider packaging when you have the choice to purchase food or drinks, packed in plastic or not. Educate yourself by reading food labels. Educate yourself by reading food labels. Choose nutritious foods over overprocessed, oversweetened, and oversalted foods. They are healthier for you, and from a public health standpoint, they reduce the pressure on our healthcare system to treat illnesses that could be avoided by choosing wisely. Compost your food waste. Rotting food waste in landfills creates methane, a greenhouse gas 20 times more potent than carbon emissions. Eating ethically and sustainably sends a message to food growers and producers. You vote with your dollars. Not too long ago, you couldn't find organic or sustainably raised animal foods in the marketplace. This is an excerpt from a sermon delivered at the Open Circle Unitarian Universalist Church in Boulder, Colorado. Think about how brave that person was. And that was Mary Gibb. Okay, let me kind of go through here. This is a picture at Yellowstone, and this is the efforts and effect of wolves on herd animals, and that's kind of what we're going to be talking about today. Buffalo are pretty safe. As you notice, the adults turn around and face the wolves and create a circle around the calves, so very seldom, unless there's a sick or injured or old or dying buffalo, do they actually become victims to wolves. Wolves, however, become victims to people. This was the last time they put bounties on wolves because hunters and trappers and livestock growers in the West thought wolves were taking too many of their animals. So they put bounties on them, and you can see the results of that. And this is a wolf howl, which if you've ever heard a wolf howl in real life, it is a pretty amazing thing. I was at the Sonoran Desert Museum in Tucson, Arizona, and they had a wolf exhibit, and I was there right at sunset, and that was a pretty incredible experience to hear it for real. All right, children's story is, naturally, Crying Wolf. Stanley and his classmates were getting ready to work on their macaroni art projects. Oh, I love that macaroni art. When their teacher, Mrs. Diaz, introduced a new student, "This is Walter," she announced to the class. "He just moved here all the way from Alaska." And Walter has a little wolf on his t-shirt, and Walter looks a little apprehensive. "Hi, Walter," shouted the class. "Cool wolf shirt," Stanley said, but Walter didn't answer. He stayed very quiet. "Why don't you tell the class something about yourself, Walter?" Mrs. Diaz suggested. "I like wolves," Walter mumbled. "That's it." At recess, Walter didn't have much to say either. He just stood by himself. "Does he not like us or something?" Stanley asked his friends. "I don't think he likes anybody," said Mimi. "What if he's a wolf?" said Marcy. "You mean like a werewolf?" Stanley asked. "They're half human and half wolf." "They're all mean and all nasty," said Lester. "That's ridiculous," Stanley said. Or was it? After school, Stanley's friends came over to his house. They started talking about Walter again. Was he really a wolf? "Did somebody cry wolf?" asked Dennis, Stanley's goldfish. "Walter is a big, bad, scary wolf," Lester said to Dennis. "Are you sure?" Dennis asked. Did you catch that? The goldfish actually joins in the conversation. I would love to be a kid again. "He doesn't like people," said Stanley, "but he likes wolves," said Marcy, "and wolves gobble up children." Soon Stanley and his friends began to feel very afraid of Walter. Would he gobble them up like the wolves in Little Red Riding Hood and the Three Little Pigs? "Those are just stories," Dennis assured them, "and stories aren't always true." That's when Stanley, with some help from his dog Harry and his cat Elsie, got out the one book that always had true stories, the great big book of everything. Then Stanley opened the book to the W section and pointed to a gray wolf. Stanley's friends jumped back. Then they looked a little closer. "He's not as big as I thought," said Lester. "That's a female," Dennis explained. "They're a bit smaller than the male gray wolves, but the males probably aren't as big as you think either. In fact," Dennis told them, "most wolves weren't much bigger than Stanley's big brother, Lionel." And there's a picture of a wolf measured up against Lionel. "Look, she's a loner, just like Walter," said Mimi. "Not for long," said Stanley. "Come on." So the kids and Dennis all jumped into the great big book of everything and landed in the snowy tundra. "This is Alaska," Dennis said, "where many gray wolves live." "Wolves are from Alaska," Lester said excited. "Walter's from Alaska." "Not all wolves are from Alaska," Dennis explained. "At one point, wolves lived all around the world, but now they mostly live in North America." Stanley watched the wolf through his binoculars. The wolf was sniffing around. Stanley wondered what she could be smelling when there was nothing but snow and ice. That's when Dennis explained that wolves can smell about 100 times better than human beings. Then suddenly the wolf picked her head up and howled, "Ooh!" She'd found what she'd been looking for, more wolves.
I think they're talking to each other, Stanley said. Right, Dennis replied. They howl to communicate. That's not scary, said Lester. That's cool. And then she's not just a wolf, Stanley said as they watched the family of wolves. She's a mom. Everyone began to realize that wolves weren't really mean at all. They could be friendly to each other. Stanley and his friends were so excited to find out that wolves were friendly, they ran down the hill toward them. Arrrr, the wolves howled. Wait, Dennis cried, but it was too late. The wolves had run away. Wolves are quite shy around animals and people they don't know, Dennis explained. Just like Walter had been at school, thought Stanley. Soon the friends jumped back into the great big book of everything and landed in Stanley's room. The next day, Stanley and his friends went to talk to Walter. They told him about the wolves they had seen. We were scared, said Stanley, but then we got to know them, said Mimi. We just like we want to get to know you, said Stanley. You do? Said Walter. I was kind of scared of you guys. You're all friends. I'm the one that nobody knows. But we know you now, said Stanley with a smile. We can all be friends. And with that, all the friends went off to play a game of catch. Okay. Good story about wolves, and you can see from the picture, wolves are very affectionate with each other, and they are pretty shy around people and animals they don't understand. We have any joys and concerns?
Yeah, like I say, thanks to the congregation for meeting Jean's tray and cards and expressing the condolences. It means quite a bit to the family. Thank you.
Yeah, we're going to miss Janet, and we appreciate the congregation's support for Kenny and the family. And there are memorials to the Diabetes Foundation and the Christmas light for New Madison, which is definitely a worthy cause. So feel free, if you weren't familiar with that, you can contact us through the Facebook, and we'll give you the addresses for those. Okay, message. Trophic Cascade. Let's see. I've got two ways to do this. Let's do the easy way first.
Okay.
Yes?
I want to tell you that Jeff has been called to the Horn of Africa. Can you hear me, Kenny? My son Jeff has been called as an envoy to the Horn of Africa, and he's on his way tomorrow. He'll be flying there tomorrow.
So there'll be a residency there then, Roberta?
I don't know how long he will be there. I'm not sure he knows.
I see.
We talked about this a little bit before. That,
yes, we did.
Because during the previous administration, the way the State Department was treated, many of the lifelong people who had contributed their lives to the State Department resigned and left in disgust. So now there's a tremendous shortage of trained and able people to cover these danger spots in the world. So they're desperately reaching out to people who have retired from before and are willing to serve again. So our respect and care and sympathy goes to Jeff for the position he's assuming. And we can hope that more people will rejoin the State Department, and Jeff's assignment there will be short, and he will be able to return home and enjoy his retirement. But we certainly thank him for his continued service to the country. Yes.
And I also just bring up, in terms of peace in the world and need in the world, you probably see on the news how catastrophic COVID has hit the country of India. They are desperate. And there's not only worldwide relief going there now, but there are lots of variety of reputable foundations, support organizations that you can contribute to for the specific parts of India or all the whole country. So I would encourage us all to be mindful of that, and if possible, to contribute to those particular millions of people in need as we speak.
And let's make a note, Prime Minister Modi of India has something in common with Bolsonaro, the Prime Minister or President of Brazil, who has something in common with both of them and with our former President Trump. They all denied the existence of a virus. They all said it was nothing more than the flu. And those three countries, including the United States, suffered hundreds of thousands of unnecessary deaths because they just dragged their feet as far as masks, as far as social distancing, as far as even producing the vaccines in a rapid time. So, and one more candle for those fears, loves, hates, those things which we
kind of hold inside, and maybe we should be able to share with somebody. And you're more than welcome to share them psychically with us. Spread them out there, and we will help you with them. Okay.
thanks to the BBC for that production. I think that gives you a pretty good idea of trophic cascades. Cascade meaning it starts at the top and flows down from one level to another level to another level. Here is a kind of artistic depiction by a pretty good artist who has kind of a childlike understanding of wildlife. Wolves, you can see on that side, reduced deer population. Then you can see at the bottom, there's more leaves on the trees and more grass and more underbrush under the trees, which means more habitat for other animals. When you eliminate the wolves on this side, the deer population increases, the browsing increases, the trees are stripped down. Remember he said that the tree height increased 5 times over 6 years because the deer and the elk, he didn't mention elk, but it's mostly elk in Yellowstone, that browse the tops off the trees in the winter. And that means less vegetation on the ground. And that creates how wolves change rivers, because with increased soil erosion and increased river flow, it eats the banks away and they collapse and more water flows down to the ocean, or more earth flows down to the ocean. When the grass is there to stabilize everything and the brush is there to stabilize everything, the water is cleaner, it makes a better habitat for the fish and all the animals and amphibians and everything that uses the water. So, okay, now we're going to extrapolate a little bit farther. Number one, a little bit of information. We've all heard about alpha males. That came from the study of wolves. Unfortunately, the study of wolves that created this scientific paper on alpha males and alpha pair was done with captive wolves in zoos, where they threw wolves from different places in together, and then they created another term that the psychologists have created, the pecking order, which originated with chickens, but it goes through all animals, and actually grade schools and up high schools and even college, there's a pecking order of people who think they're superior to other people and enforce that one way or another. It turns out that in real life wolf families, there is an alpha male and alpha female, but it's not surrounded by strange wolves that they correct or coerce into behaving. The pups, when they're raised, stick around for 1 or 2 or 3 years, and that's the pack. And like any other pack or any other family, the children show respect to the elders. So the elders tell the children what to do and what not to do. They teach them how to hunt. They teach them how to hunt as a group, as a proactive group. And when food is scarce, the elders eat first, the young pups eat, and then the older pups eat last. And they're told that you don't go in and eat until everybody else has had their fill. When that was observed, and they were talking about alpha males, and that was the next conclusion they came to, was that wolves enforce their discipline through force. That is also not supposedly true in the latest understanding of scientific research. It is a cooperative understanding of choice and direction by the parents, but not force. And this use of force has been transferred, it's almost into the military and into the actual, if you've got a dog and took it to a training class, it used to be that dogs were trained by forcing. Remember, rubbing his nose in it? If a dog did his business in the house by mistake, you rubbed his nose in it, or you pick him up by the scruff of the neck and shake him, because they'd seen an aggressive dogs between each other. They'll grab one by the scruff of the neck, and the less dominant, the obedient dog will crouch down and turn on his back and turn his stomach up as a sign of submission. That's all something that these guys have understood, or these people, these scientists have understood from watching captive wolves, not something that happens in real life. So now we go, remember I told you before we were going to go a little bit into a projection of what we're talking about with human civilization. Number one, this is in Idaho. I related earlier before we started filming that in Utah, they had a Republican gathering last week. Mitt Romney, who is the senator from Utah, a former presidential candidate, and former governor, a successful governor of Massachusetts, was booed by the crowd. More than 70% of the Republicans in Utah and Idaho think that the last election was fraudulent and Donald Trump should be the president of the United States, and the 7 million votes that the current president had in excess of Donald Trump were fraudulent. This is an incredible amount of disbelief in reality. This kind of turns into what happens with civilizations as they rise and fall. They've done a study of the Pueblos The Pueblo Indians, remember we had last week when Nancy was here, I showed you the slides of the Mesa Verde and Gila National Park with the cliff dwellings. These societies rose and fell, and the original understanding was that they rose and fell related to the climate. When there was a drought, they collapsed. And when there was plentiful rain and plentiful crops, they rose again. It turns out, later research again, and I can say as a hallmark of science, you can change your mind. You follow the facts wherever they lead, even if it's something you don't want to believe. If the facts lead you there, that's where you go. But nothing is inviolate, nothing is beyond questioning. You question everything, and you maintain some kind of level sense of human dignity while you're doing it, which is sorely lacking now. Which brings me to the studies they've done of tree rings, dendrology, the study of tree rings. When they build the pueblos, they use trees to create the beams to hold the one story above another story, and to outline the doors and the walls and things like that. It turns out that not all of the rising and falling was connected to the droughts. There were droughts that the pueblos survived by using correct water management and husbandry and taking care of the land and the crops they were growing. And then there were times when and by the tree rings they could tell when there were more things being built and then when there was nothing being built. They found out that some of the times that the collapses were happening were kind of almost coinciding with the climate, but not quite. The conclusion they're reaching, and this is just a supposition at the moment, just a theory, was that these societies were under stress, and one of the main problems they were having was inequality. When the rich, in one instance, when the society suffered a collapse or suffered a major threat, such as a drought, the rich or the well-off or the more intelligent helped everybody else and maintained social cohesion and made the society progress. And when the rich turned to save themselves and take care of themselves and the devil take the hindmost, that's when the society was in the biggest chance of collapse, at the biggest proclivity to kind of disappear. This is what I think we're observing right now when people are saying, I want mine and I don't care if anybody else gets theirs. When the people who are at the top of our country, the business leaders and everyone else, think that having billions of dollars every year is not too little. And when some people below them think that other people who make billions of dollars a year is no problem because maybe I'll get to that place sometime and I can have billions of dollars a year and I can lord it over those people below me who don't. That is a sign of social disintegration. To me, we're in one of those kind of ebbs and flows. We're in a flow of social disintegration now. So we'll have to see if there's anything to that scientific theory, and knowing me, we'll be following along, and any information I find, I'll be passing along to you. So, let's see, is there anything I missed? I don't think. So, you can follow through with that if you have any interest in it. And it's time for our offering. This is a offering as a statement by Victoria Weinstein, who is another one of my favorite authors from the UU website. Every week in our church, we take up an offering. It's good to remind ourselves from time to time that the offering is symbolic as well as practical. We know this. We know that through pledges that we build our budget and fund our yearly programs and ministries of worship and religious education, pay our staff, which we're not, professional religious leaders, and finance the comfort and beauty of our buildings. And we know that we could easily submit those pledge checks to the church at any convenient time. But we come to the plate during our worship service to make a community expression of thanks for the blessing of abundance, to visibly bring in the harvest at this most cherished hour of our week. Our offering says that the act of giving is essential to our spiritual well-being as anything else we do here on a Sunday morning. This is also the first Sunday of the month, so it's Fish Sunday. If you would like to put something in the fish plate, or if you have actual goods, we'll try to get back to that. If I forget in the future, please remind me on the first Sunday. Okay. Mm-hmm.
didn't recognize that, it didn't pull out from your mind, tiptoe through the tulips, and because it's Fish Sunday, I think that's why all the wolves are lined up. They heard it was Fish Sunday, and they're looking for the fish. Okay. Give us pleasure in the flowers today, and I'm sure other people have noticed the hummers are back. They've been at my feeder for 3 days now, and that is always a joy. To extinguish our chalice, our closing words of our Norman V. Naylor. Space made sacred by our presence, take with you at least some seed of understanding, hope, and courage, and drop it into the confusion of the world. Nourish the seed that might grow as a tree of life, giving shelter to the weary and hope to despairing. Be yourself a branch of the tree of life. Amen. And we're a little bit early. Does anyone have any comments on the trophic Cascade?
I'm curious if wolves have natural predators above them in the food chain.
I have a feeling grizzly bears will predate on wolves if given a chance. I think the family structure, and once again, in my limited reading, 2 and 3 years old, they go out and start their own territory. They find a mate from another pack, and then they become the alpha males and have a litter. And when there's one wolf or only two wolves by themselves, and if one of them becomes injured or something is sick or something like that, then they are going to be victim of anything else in the natural world. So I don't think that's kind of what it means to be the top of the food chain. Humans are the top of the food chain, but if you saw the news, there was a woman killed and eaten by a grizzly bear in Colorado this week. I'm not sure what happened. She said she went out for a walk with her two dogs, and the husband came home, the two dogs were there, and his wife was gone, and when they went looking for her, they found her, and they found parts of her. And then they euthanized the bear that they thought was the responsible one, so I'm hopeful it was the bear that was responsible, not some innocent bystander bear that was taken out. But, you know, what kind of dogs she may have had a heart attack or something else and then collapsed, because black bears are not really known for being aggressive toward humans. But, you know, one never knows, and people jump to conclusions all the time, so. Anything else? This is a kind of a long-term subject. I encourage people to follow through with this. And knowing me, I'll be bringing you tidbits of whatever I find and throwing them in as we go willy-nilly. Okay, our POS glue. You do something for me. I love that kind of rhythmic slowing down, almost like a cascade. We have a surplus of food today, so feel free. I have, as I usually do, I went to Walmart and whatever was on the day old table cheap, I brought it. But we also have, Roberta has brought some stuff, and Kenny was nice enough to bring some stuff that they had a little bit extra of. The coffee pot is plugged in, so we'll turn it up to boil, and you can have coffee and snacks. So that is our service this Sunday morning, beautiful spring Sunday morning from First Universalist. Feel free to contact us if you need anything. And hopefully everybody's got their shots. It's still, I throw this in at the end, the danger is not yet past. There's a certain percentage of people who refuse to get their shots, so the virus is still spreading. And even if you've had your shots, you can still get the virus, you just won't get as sick. So wear your mask, keep your social distancing. I don't care. And I noticed at the funeral, like 20 people out of whatever, there was 150 there, probably 20 people had masks on. So it's, and I took mine off to greet the family, but I put it right back on again. So let's use common sense, please. So that's the end of today. Hope to see you next week.